University of Bern. I finished soon. So let's get to the point directly. I work with these quality rules, and some time ago we thought, like, which rules do we have in Faro? It would be nice to, like, show the guidelines to people, like, yeah, we have these guidelines. So Gisha did this export of our quality rules information. But then the problem is that you can read the titles and you can read some explanations, and still it's not clear, like, what should I do? So it would be nice to have something like this, where you have essentially, okay, here is a good example, here is a bad example, please, like, do not do this stuff, because it will first do OR and then compare it, and then definitely it will not work, please put parentheses here. And this is not done currently in the stupid way, so this is something that my student did, Lars Hoplin. And essentially, when you have this rule class, what you can do, you can go for now to the class side, and you can see, okay, I have a good example, it looks like this, and I have a bad example and it looks like this. Also, there is a warning here. And this is nice because we have actual objects that can be good or bad, so we can reuse them. And as you can see, we hacked in these buttons from tests, and they are hard to implement in Nautilus, so I hope that in Calypso it's easier. But then you program your rule, you define an example, and then you click on it, and then you see, oh, it works. And with this one, okay, it works. And then if we would remove this stuff, the thing will fail. So we can see, okay, we can immediately, like, try out what is working and what is not working. And then the same information is used to generate the snippet. So we have other examples that we tried to implement, for example, here, that you shouldn't use equals true and so on.
But so, yeah. When it doesn't, when it fails the test, it means that that you run the rules on top of it, and the rule says it is
the rule
wrong.
It depends on the example. So this is a good example, and the rule said that this is bad.
Okay, that
so
you have it.
This wrong. Doesn't make sense. Okay.
Okay, it's not, and that you run the code.
Yeah. Okay. Another thing which is really cool.
Does it mean so if everything will be correct here and will show red?
Yes, yeah. Or you have a wrong example. It's always with test. If you have a bad test, you know, what are you checking? Another thing which was requested 3 years ago, now you can go to the catalog and you can get debugger critiques. So you can install that directly from the catalog. And after that, if you have a debugger on something and you debug, bam, you have critiques in here and you can see the stuff. So if you want to shoot yourself in the leg in debugger, we try to warn you. So please use it and let us know if we can improve it. And then we experimented with even more stuff. And I have it in this image, I suppose.
But shouldn't this stuff be by default in the system?
It would be nice. The problem is that we hack the debugger a bit, because it's not straightforward to do that. And my main idea is that I have a model for critiques. So it's really straightforward. You just ask, like, hey, method, what are your critiques? And you get nice objects.
So
and
you
then
should push Andrei so that we have a much better.
Yeah, we were discussing about that. Anyway, so this is a complete experiment. And what we did is that, for example, you have some product which has a name and then amount. And then if you want to print it, you want to say name, X, this number of things. And if you do something like that, we should say product new string. If you do that, it says instances of small integer are not indexable. Okay, it's implemented like this, but in reality, the problem is that we try, if you see this method, we try to concatenate amount, which is a number, with a string. And because it's implemented as a collection with comma and it's not indexable, you have this message. But during debugging, you can see that this is a string and this is a number. And this is exactly what we do. So when you go into debugging, you see this thing that you cannot concatenate byte string with a small integer, and you can click on that and it shows you exactly, okay, here is your problem, and you can click on auto fix, and then it says like, yeah, you know, I can cast it to string. So this is really cool because this means that we can do static analysis on dynamic data. Because R is super dynamic, but when it runs and when it breaks, we have the information of what is going on. And then we can really do interesting checks. And
how many of rules like that do you
have? This is the one which is really reasonable. We have two more. But essentially, yeah, again, this is a work which was done by our master student, who is Kevin Shibley, and he was supervised by Claudio Parodi, my colleague. And the thing is that the student was not too enthusiastic and we didn't have time to push it much farther. But it's about the possibility. And then another thing is that you have critiques here also, which collects all critiques from all the stack and tells you, okay, you have them here. And this is not the point. The point would be if it will tell you like, hey, look, in this method that you are invoking, there are 3 error level critiques. Maybe your problem is because of that. So yeah.
And you
we should
to
stop.
Extend the table.
Yeah, we should stop.
Okay, I'm just like saying the closing stuff. Okay. So I'm finishing, and somewhere on Twitter I tweeted a video about me that I'm finishing my PhD and I'm looking for a job. So you can hire me, if or you can at least retweet it and have an impact on the future, you know? So it's in my feed. I don't know, maybe I can retweet it so it moves to the top. Yeah. Anyway, thank you.
Yes.
You know, people should pay for advertisement tags.
Yeah.
Okay. So my project is just a small thing because I started programming Faro this year. Actually, that's something I did after 4 weeks of learning Faro. I was taught by Mr. Boakadi and Mr. Fabres. I hope I won't put them at shame. So it's just simply Tetris, but I wanted to do a desktop app. I didn't want to give a full development window to users. I just wanted them to have an app and a little game. So I'm going to show it to you. And then I'm going to tell you what I did a bit and what I want to do afterward. So first of all, sorry I'm on Windows. I know it can anger a lot of you, but I have a computer problem, so please don't kill me.
We deserve a decent.
We need money to work.
No, you need more Max. You don't have enough yet. So.
Play.
Well, it's Tetris. I know. I think you already.
With some classic songs.
No, that's something I want to talk about because I don't find the good libraries on Faro for that. So that's simply a Tetris, and I'm quite bad at the game, so I'm still going to try to fix some lines.
Not enough practice.
It helped me practice Faro and Tetris at the same time.
Yeah,
so.
Yes.
Okay, so you can see lines clearing, and I won't go much further because you can do that at home, or I can give you the.
Yeah, you should read seven announcements.
Yeah, maybe in the main list. Okay. Something I wanted to talk about is that I had some troubles to deploy this app because there are no good class deployer.
Yes.
So I used a framework that Mr. Boakadi started but stopped because since Morphic is supposed to die out and the thing was calling Morphic, we stopped the development.
You know that since I joined the community, which was in 2007,
we are telling that morphing is going to happen.
So it will happen, it will, we will continue telling you.
Some said that about
I know that as
I'm young, I have hope.
About the Tetris, one good thing is that I wanted the app to be small, so, and I didn't want people to be able to click and go to system browser, so when you try to extend the window, nope. And when you want to do many things, you can, but the bad thing is that you can still use shortcuts, and it doesn't, if I'm able to open it, it doesn't look especially good when it works. I don't want users to be able to do that, but I wasn't able to put all the features I wanted. And okay, so
but you know, you should resend it to the menu list, and then you should remake it.
No, but I can remake it myself. I have more time now. So I didn't have much time this year because I had to do a website in PHP because of Mr. Fabres. We love you.
You have to do that before enjoying Corey Faro.
Yeah, but you should put it not in French, right?
Yes, I was new at the time, please.
Yeah, okay.
Actually, I'm refactoring the code while I do new feature. Actually, if I don't go too much in the code because it's especially badly made, I can work better now. Just again, just to show a Tetris with lights, but lagging a lot, so that's one of the problems with it, and that's why I don't release it yet, because it has a lot of freezes. And actually, I don't release it for another reason. I happened to stumble upon the Tetris guideline because I didn't know that, but Tetris has its own ISO norm, basically. And if you don't release a Tetris game, you have to follow them. So, yeah, indispensable rules, I have most of them, but I still don't have the T-spin, the ghost piece, which I didn't know what it was, so it's really for nerds of Tetris, which I'm not, but I'm still gonna try to implement it.
But you should release before.
Yeah, maybe. But when it's actually not freezing anymore. And the last thing that you have to have, like you said, is the Tetris music. It's you have to do it in the Tetris guidelines, but I don't find good music libraries in Faro to use music, so maybe it's because I'm a noob, but I don't know how to put good.
Put the sound level at zero. What? Yeah. Put the sound level at zero.
That'd be fine. And yes, the proper app deployer, because as you can see, I had to hide the mess in a hidden file, and I just put a simple script. But that's not the best portable way to do it. I'd like to have just one exe with the image already started and nothing else. So I have to work on that because I don't think it has been done yet. And actually, I wanted to put it on the web too using C-side, but since we can't do single web page application yet because JavaScript is not completely integrated in Faro, I can do that because if I have to reload the page every time a new piece comes in, it's not going to be a fun game to play.
But do something. I like what you did, just release the game as soon as you remove the French, and then people can play first, and then after.
Yeah, I want to increase everything.
Improvement over perfection. And sure. Release perfection.
I'll release as soon as I have
a suggestion for future, try to implement not Tetris. There is a company called Stub Yourself that take old games and re-implement them, and essentially not Tetris. When you land the piece which is on the side of the other piece, it like rolls down and falls and, you know.
Okay, maybe I'll
check that out.
That seems like a fun one. So that's about it, about this project. Do you have questions? Apart from the release date, when I have time. So.
How was the reason for freeze?
Because I just started coding and I coded badly at the time. So I didn't figure it out that yet. Otherwise, I would have removed it. So I'll just look into it. I think I used too many two processes at the time, which was unneeded. So sometimes the processor has to reassign the active process and waste time basically.
You try to block, but you block.
Not yet. So I'm gonna do an internship on that this year. So maybe next year I'll come with a version that is used with block to have transparent from those pieces.
That's very important.
Suppose, this is 3 minutes.
Okay. So 3 minutes per slide.
If it's in PHP, we're talking zero.
I have a class called my banana. I will create an instance, another instance, and evaluate if they are equals. The class is basically, it's empty. It has a method that says color, and that's it.
It's a banana.
So compared to bananas, and it's false. It is natural behavior. No. Two bananas are equal. It should be equals. Why it's there? So, to fix the problem, I have to go and add a method. See, basically, if they have the same, the return, then this time I get true.
Right.
Okay? Are we done? Not yet. Because if I try to put my bananas in a basket,
set.
Says two. Sets is supposed to ensure unicity. So it's not enough to have equal.
Power is broken.
No, this is history. This is inheritance from small talk world. So we have to add an extra method called hash. And they add hash. Basically. Because sets actually it's a hash table, and now it says.
What you're saying is it should have been wheat or hash.
So, and this problem occurs again and again, and this is why we have in the image of this sparrow pipe, we have 233 implementation of equals and almost the same of hash.
Oops.
Oops. It's not working.
Well, they should be the same.
No, but then you can imagine inheritance. There are some stuff really related to tests. I didn't check all, but it's more, it's close. So it makes sense. If it were, they were a factor of difference. So now let's continue with my example. Now I introduce extra fruits. Okay, the point is already there. So how I got other fruits with different colors. So I need to do, not only check if they have the same, those are supposed to be different, of course. And what do I want to do? Yes, but to ensure equality, I need to check whether it's the same class. Okay, let's share it in superclass and the hash. I put it in superclass of banana and apple. So still it does not work here. It says true and does not work because I want it to be false because they have different colors. So I need to re-implement again another method which is another equal. In apple this time, saying okay. They are equal because they have the same class and the same color. So now it works, they have different colors, so it's false. If we change color back to yellow, so then it will be true. Okay, it's working. So let's put it back to red. And try with the set. And this time I have mixed fruits, bananas and apples. Okay, my window is too small.
and I get two. So again, I need the hash method. So you see, it's annoying. We need to implement this again and again. And those are trivial code. And you look through the image, it's basically more or less, this is this bit XOR. OK, let's show that it fixed the issue. Yes, now we have a. OK, so and to fix the issue, OK, once for all, there is a thread for this. And you don't need to have all these equals and everything. Just say uses t equal equality. Okay, what it broke something. Oh, okay, of course.
Name.
Just to speak the code. Name.
I need to, no, I need to have the right superclass. Uses t equality. Forget about the old. Methods. Okay, remove it, please. Remove it. And remove the other hash.
Thread
is useful. Threads are useful.
It's not even broken.
So remove it. So basically, it does once for all the magic. I mean, basically, we are comparing the class and instance variables most of the time. And now, hopefully, all this should work. And we should have. Yes, I didn't re-implement. Okay. Yes, now it works. This is what, because I didn't re-evaluate this. So, with one thread, so just when we need equality, use this thread. And it's relatively clearly implemented. And so you don't need to write, so if you look at the existing code implementation of equals, it's basically, they are comparing instance variables, they are checking if we have the same species again and again, and this is stupid code and we don't need to bother about this. And extra bonus, when giving lecture to students like Theo, when we introduce equal, we don't need to have collections and explain that we need a hash because there is set and there is a difficulty to teach.
Did you try to remove some of them to introduce threads in object?
I tried to play with objects and change equality objects and then it quickly breaks, so okay. But now with bootstrapping the image, hopefully we should be able to rebuild image with this embedded from by default. And then we will not need the thread anymore because we have implementation as object. And then if you don't, you can of course customize it and decide which instance variables you want to use for comparison. There are a few examples, and the code is available since years on Smalltalk Hub.
Yeah, because you put it by default, because if you want, you redefine it.
Yes, of course. That's it.
You should open an issue.
I think we go on the
right.
Yeah.
Who's next?
Sophie.
I go
after
or
I?
Okay.
So
Paolo.
No.
You.
No.
Okay. Perfect. Hello, I'm Alex. I work on the blog, and you know, everybody knows what is a code editor, right? It's one of the central tools in an IDE. And this is how a conceptual code editor looks like. So you can select the text. You can navigate. You can edit. You can add a new line. And the code that you see in this method is just takes a date and a file with a list of messages and just returns how many messages were sent after this date per user. So it's nothing special. And now imagine that this method is in a context of live objects. So every variable is bound to an actual object. And do you know any text or code editors that take advantage of this. I don't know many. And now let's just dream for a few minutes. What if this code editor would exist? So let's see. Imagine this is a debugger, and we get a date. I'd like to learn about what is this object. One way this would be to select code and inspect it. But you get a new window. Why would you need to get a new window? Why would you need to leave your debugger because it's on the full screen? What we could do, we could just replace this almost useless piece of text with the graphical representation of this object. Let's replace it. You get a calendar. The same could be done for a file. I select and I replace. But then we get a folder. Let's select it. And now let's print the content. So let's print a textual representation. And what just happened? So I can navigate. And the interest in that. It doesn't have a columns. It doesn't break a syntax highlighter, right? And just to prove that a syntax highlighter actually works, so I can modify the variable, and it's red. However, this is a textual representation can be limited. That is why let's embed the graphical representation of this folder below. Text is gone, and we get a folder with the content. But then, of course, we can see after every step what's the state. All messages, latest messages. But then, if you want to know what exactly this method returns, let's select this and let's replace it. And you'd see a dictionary that for every user, in this case, we get exactly one message.
How like is it, for example, you replace sender with something else? That's
the
representation
will be automatically.
It's a dream, I said.
Oh, you are mean. No, you know how to dream, you know, we like to dream.
Thanks. It's a dream.
It's a teaser. But when will it be released?
Okay. So hello, I am Thibaut. I'm working here as a PhD, and my work basically is on making on a low level support for interaction. So my goal is to bring flexibility to the work of people who want to create and hack around user interfaces. So it's kind of magic. So here, I'm going to show you two things. The first is, so let's say I have this window here, and I want to animate it, but pretty simply. So first, I'm going to modify its position. I execute this, it moves the position. Now, if I want to animate this without having to learn any fancy stuff, any animation class or stuff, I just... I just put during. Yeah. Ta-da. So, the cool thing with this is that it doesn't know actually that window is supposed to have any position, so it works with any message.
Okay. If you get it on camera, I can repeat this by moving it first back and then doing it again.
Moving it back?
Yeah, move it back and then do it again.
Okay.
A video of it.
For the internet.
For the internet, yes.
in diagonal.
It's all about math.
Okay, let's say. So I'm going to create and then it returns an animation object. So I can also animate the animation. It's like a meta animation.
Oh, yeah. You know that we like that kind of
yeah,
stuff.
Yeah. Anyway, let's say I'm going to move it to 100, 500. Going to put this in an animation during 5 seconds. And I'm going to move this one to 5 seconds too. Watch as it turns slowly. So if you imagine it had its target on the far right, and then its target moved as the animation was going. So it made like a slight deviation. Wicked. Yeah, and for the rest, I can also, for the example, animate window titles. Booyah. Okay, now another work. So basically the core that I'm working on right now is about function reification. This extracts a message send. So we look at the function closure, at the closure, and we extract the message send from it. And from this, then we can play with this. So the animation object was just getting the receiver, the selector, and inferring an animation from that. But we can do more. This is a short syntax for metallics. I'm going to do it again. So this is basically an easy form to express the cause consequence. On the left is the cause, mouse click. On the right is the consequence. So here this means that whenever mouse click execute, so whenever mouse receives a message click, execute this. This is an event-based expression with one-liner for events. So this is basically I'm exploring how to express events with this with the metalinks. This is quite advanced stuff. So and if it returns true, the metalink becomes permanent. So I create this, and then whenever I click, it executes my code. All right. So then you can do all sorts of funny things, like I can install my own shortcut. K, I know K, and then wait, did I have a window? So I'm going to open my window again. Widget examples, please. Widget examples. Example window with two bars. What?
Now if you press tab, it sometimes seems to go funny.
Yeah.
You have to press enter. Then.
Window. I'm going to type it on toolbars, please. So here's my window. So. Here, when I press Command K, it's gonna move my window back to its old to a different position with an animation. And the animation is going to be permanent. I think this should be fine. So I install the link. Now, yeah. So I press Command K, and whenever I press Command K, it just moves my window to its to a position. So this is it. It's an event-based mechanism based on one layer. That's it. Thank you.
Oh, Sophie!
And then we start the boring stuff.
Wow! How much time do I have left? Like 30 seconds?
All of it.
Yeah,
7
minutes.
Okay.
And then we will be late. Yeah.
Yeah.
Pablo.
Pablo, está cambiando de imagen. Estás alumiando.
Okay. Good.
Elle a du goût.
I just don't know how to fix this, so I will just show you what I'm working on. So I'm a Google Summer of Code student for this year, for our consortium, and I'm working on improving the VM profiler. So right now it only exists in Squid, and yeah.
But we are protected as long as you use Mac.
It will do that way. So right now it's only available in Squid. So my main goals for my Google Summer of Code is to port it to Faro and then to improve it. Sorry?
It cannot be bad.
No. Yeah, so sorry, it's not as fancy as Thibo, who is like make Windows moves, but yeah. So I can show you what I've done so far, because right now it's working in Faro, headless, so no UI for the moment. But for instance, if I profile this code, then, oh god! Then you can see where the time is spent in the code generated by the JIT, and where the time is spent in the C code of the EVM. So, well, that's fancy, I like it, but it could still be improved, because, for the moment, so it says where the time is spent, where, the main methods where the time is spent, but it doesn't say
where in the method the time is spent, and where it starts to get interesting, because as we improve the JIT and inline more and more method, then then it starts to be really necessary actually to have this feature. So well, let's say maybe next week or in the next 2 weeks, the Faro profiler will be available in the Faro catalog. So I need you to test it and tell me, give me your feedback so I can improve it. And then, well, I'm supposed to work on the profiler until August. So then I will improve the profiler and then get a more detailed profiling. And maybe if I have time, I will try to have a UI in Faro for the profiler. So well, that's basically it.
Cool. I just have a question. Where is Clément?
He's here.
Ouais.
Clément.
Raté. Do you think that this information we could do you think that we could use the GT inspector to display those kinds of information?
Yeah, sure.
So no, it depends on the report, because right now you have a textual representation, so it means like okay, yes, you get text.
Yeah.
So and if you would get.
But that's the headless mode. So there is a mode with a UI, with a graph and squig, and but it's based on the squig morphic. So we could do something similar in Faro or something different. We can discuss.
Yeah. Okay. Okay. So thanks a lot. You see this.
Yes, like that. No, but open. I want to type something.
In Faro?
In the image that you had open.
Ah, okay, so wait. I'm opening the image back for you. What is he going to do? Wait, I'm going to save my image first and backup.
Two backups.
Yeah. You never know.
Okay, I'm the first. No, I will not execute any code, I will just type.
Yeah, just wait, it takes time to boot. I don't know.
Because you have a lot of metadata that you never.
I think so, but I don't know where they are.
So,
you know.
Oh, it's in French.
Yeah, we